Welcome to Podcast with a Student in the English section and with me, Les Camilla. Hola a todos, ¿cómo están hoy? Do you remember what we heard in the previous chapters? For example, in episode 5, where my friend Chesir and I talked in the episode of For the Latin American Spain, from Morocco and the United States of America. For example, episode 6, where we also talked with her about other Spanish speaker regions in the Spanish island of the Pacific, on the Philippines, Juan, and the Carolinas. Or episode 7, where my friend Monse Diaz and I tell the chapter about Equatorial Guinea Spanish and Spanish Judeo. Or do you remember the first part of this special? If you do not know what I am talking about, or do not remember very well what you have heard, I suggest to you go and listen to all the episodes so you can get into this new chapter. You will see all the episodes on Anchor, Spotify, Apple Podcasts, and other platforms. On YouTube, I will deliver the cards in the video. Today, we have Chesir with us telling this episode. Hello, Chesir. How is it going?
Hello, everyone. I'm Ches, and I'm glad to be here with you one more time.
Thank you so much, Ches, for being here. Today's theme is complementary to all other episodes because we continue to look for more territories where Spanish has been thought as an official, de facto, or yearly language. Let us hear where the Spanish language has been spoken on the planet. How were the Anglo-Spanish relation, Spain's relation with England, as we know, were in neither friendship nor for good during the time, beyond the brief marriage of Philip II to Mary I of England. In fact, between 1585 and 1604, an Anglo-Spanish war was waged with an important religious component, which has a critical moment: the defeat of the invincible Spanish navy in 1588 and the peace treaty signed in 1604, by which a weakened England came to recognize Spain as the power of Europe. Another fact, King James I said before the Spain ambassador in 1617, of course, I know that in terms of greatness, the King of Spain is greater than all the kings of the Christianity together, and the Spain language was part of the English culture imagination as much as French could be at the time. The resonance of Spain culture in England is also illustrated by the fact that the first translation of Quixote was made in English in 1612 by Thomas Shelton, followed by that of César Udin in French in 1614, both before the publication of the second part of the novel.
From the time of the Empire, with the legend of the Navy, and more specifically from the War of Succession, in the early 18th century to the War of Independence, a century later, relations between Spain and England have always been very difficult, says Moreno Alonso in his subtitle, a country watch of another. Hostilities proved inevitable during the reign of Philip V, Charles III, and Charles IV. Therefore, the most frequent was that relations between Spain and England became a continuous finding, which explains much the vision that one country had of the other.
So much so that there were few Spanish ministers who were always clear that the main culprit from Spain's misfortunes and misadventures abroad and at home was still England. Ad Manuel Moreno Alonso, professor of contemporary history at the University of Sevilla.
How were Franco-Spanish relations? Relations with France, always close and fluid, had their period of sealing and their time of confidence. In the 16th century, there were moments of tension, as the explanations of the famous Spanish, César Houdin showed. According to Houdin, his own works on Spanish wrote them not out of love for Spain, but so that his comparisons would learn firsthand about the atrocities committed during the conquest of America, and so that the French captains could discover the tactics of the Spaniards. In the 17th century, however, things changed, especially thanks to state marriage between Austrian and French houses. Philip II married Elizabeth of Valois. Louis XIII of France married Anne of Austria. daughter of Philip III. Philip IV married Elizabeth de Bourbon. The desire to insulate England strengthened Spanish-Austrian relations, to the point that many French people crossed the Farnese in the 17th century to perform all kind of jobs in Spanish, such as merchants, farmers, shepherds, and other people of modest and less modest trades. All this contributed to the Spanish language being fashionable in France, which led Miguel Cervantes to include in his work Los Trabajos de Persiles y Sigismunda of 1617. The following statement, something exaggerated, is: in France, neither men nor women stop learning the Castilian language, and it's significant that this work was published simultaneously in several cities in Spain, Lisbon in Portugal, and Paris in France.
And were relations with Italy good, bad, or intermediate? As for the links between Spain and Italy, they have come from afar. It shows that it was the opening in 1374 of the Royal College of San Clemente de los Españoles, created at the University of Bologna at the initiative of Cardinal Gil de Albornoz, and which continues to receive Spanish students. However, relations have been particularly close since the second half of the 15th century, when the Borgia family of Valencian origin saw Alejandro Borgia become Pope Calixto III, then Rodrigo Borgia in Pope Alexander VI in 1492.
Let us remember that many Spanish Jews ended up in Italy, where they were protected after the expulsion. It is not for nothing that the first complete Bible printed in Spanish was Bible of Ferrara in 1553. Thus, it can be said that from that moment on, the Spanishization of Italy was intense, almost as much as the Italianization of Spain culture. Apart from the papal court, the Italian regions closest to Spain was undoubtedly Naples, a Spanish province between the 16th and 18th centuries, ruled by viceroys, acting on behalf of the Spanish monarch. Logically, these historical facts familiarize the inhabitants of the Italic peninsula, especially those in the south, with the Spanish language, as the phrase of Juan Valdez, parallel, albeit before, to the aforementioned Cervantes on France, in Italy, as in the gentleman you have for kindness and gallantry, know how to speak Spanish.
As we have heard, the influence of the four powers was quite extensive. Spain had its bad time with England, but it did strengthen its relation with France, which, although they also had some drawbacks, there were also links that we were beneficial to both nations and were able to cleanse their rottenness. And Italy was more stable, kind, and reciprocal relationship. Italy and Spain were enriched by their contact or by their culture, which introduced new artistic and religious movement, because speech was also affected.
Do you think the influence of speech has been as it was in England, France, and Italy? What do you think of Spain's past relations with these countries? Do you think that the union of England with Portugal has affected relations with Spain?
What do you think of his relationship with France? What do you think of the ancient Italian high society that was sought to learn Spanish? Much of this information I took from the book The Wonderful History of Spanish, written by Francisco Moreno Fernandez and published by the Instituto Cervantes y Espasa. In addition, other sources were consulted, such as Spanish 302 in the subject Territories Inedere by Charles V in Europe and the Mediterranean, as well as the newspaper El País in the Note of History of a Rivality, written by Santiago Velastegui Goita. You can follow me on my social networks here on the site, but if you tune me through another channel, I am on Facebook, Instagram, Twitter, as well as on YouTube, like Podcast with a Student, where we can find you, Chess.
You can follow me on Twitter as Keoli.
I remind you that you can send me messages through all my social networks. In Anchor, you can also send messages. And if you are watching us on YouTube or Instagram, leave your comments down below for comment and answer all the questions asked. See you later.
Bye, see you soon, and remember to stay tuned.